Welcome to Sleepy Hollow Presbyterian Church on this very, very special Sunday. We are so excited to be here together today celebrating Earth Sunday and giving thanks for the beauty of this earth and all the blessings that the Creator has bestowed upon us. And this is a youth-led service. We have our young people reading the text today, and we are so blessed by two wonderful speakers. I'm gonna have to find where they went. Hayley Ballard is right in front of me, and that always happens. I cannot see what's right in front of me, unfortunately. Hayley, we are so happy that you're here, and you'll be introduced right before you get up and speak when everybody's here. But thank you. Hayley's a San Domenico student, born environmentalist and naturalist, and a person with great passion, and we're so grateful to you to be here this morning for our Earth Sunday celebration. And then we also have Jason Simon. So our message here is really that we want the young people of today to understand that, you know, that making the earth sustainable for the next generations, including their own, is not all on their shoulders, that we're allies, that we're partners. And Jason may not seem, to me, Jason seems very young. However, youthful. However, he isn't in high school anymore. And Jason has a wonderful background in renewable energy and all things green. And so we're really looking forward to hearing from him as well. And then, in addition to those two really special treats, we have today the ordination and installation of our three new elders joining the session. So you'll know them by their corsage. So we'll introduce them when we get to that part of the service, and we're just really excited about that too. So let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship in your bulletin. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. The world is a holy place. We gather to rededicate ourselves to caring for the earth. Let us give thanks for our Creator and the goodness of creation.
Make yourself at home. And now let's all stand and sing number 664, Morning Has Broken. And you can pull out your purple hymnal or read the lyrics from the bulletin.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the word. Sweet the rains new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God's feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the springing fresh from the
seated. Please join me in the unison prayer printed on page 2 of your bulletin. Gracious God, fill us with gratitude for the beauty and bounty of the earth. Free us from fear, anxiety, and defeatism. Make us justice seekers and creative, courageous stewards of the earth. Grant us compassion and wisdom, and energize us for service to the world. Now please take a moment and just listen for God's voice for you today. If it's the voice of love, it's the voice of God. Amen. So hear now your assurance of grace. The grace of God is the most important gift you can ever receive in life. It's the gift of God's companionship, God's grace, God's presence, living in you, walking with you each step of life. We just have to say yes. We just have to remember to open our heart and make space in our life for this gift of God. Every time we hear a bird, every time we see the beauty of the earth, let that be a reminder of God's love, ever present. So believe this good news. God loves you. God accepts you as you are. Amen. Now, as people who are beloved by God and have the gift of God's peace residing in our heart, let us share the sign of God's peace with one another. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Let us pass the peace. Peace. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. Oh my gosh, I don't want to have my back to anyone. Let's see if I can turn this around. All right. We have to make a bigger circle. Push back, push back. This is a great thing. I love it when we have to push back because we have a bigger circle. All right. Let's move it all down this way a little bit. Okay, here. Yay. Fantastic circle construction. Does this look like a circle? Maybe it looks more like an Easter egg, but that's good. That's a good thing. Okay, so let's say our names. I'll start. I'm Bev. All right, and let's get the teachers in. We're welcoming Jack as our new teacher today, so this is exciting. Thank you, teachers, for being here. We're really glad you're here. Can you tell me your name again? That's right. I knew that. All right. Well, welcome, everybody. So today is Earth Sunday. So we're giving thanks for the earth because the Bible tells us that God created the earth and made all this beauty and all this wonderful nature and, you know, food growing for all of us, including all the creatures, and all this wonderful beauty and bounty is because God loves us all so much. So that's what the Bible tells us. And we know also from the Bible, and we have some wonderful readers lined up. Let's see, reader, yes, who's going to tell us right in the first book of the Bible, in Genesis, Spencer's going to read a verse from chapter 2, that God gave us the earth and put us in this beautiful garden to take care of it. So I know you kids hear a lot about taking care of the earth and about taking care of the planet. Sometimes I think, especially for the big kids, these kids like Hayley, our speaker today, it can feel almost heavy. Like, oh my gosh, I'm just a junior in high school. How am I supposed to take care of the whole planet, right? I mean, right? Do you feel like sometimes it's heavy, right? So it's super important to know that it's not all this heavy burden on kids, but that all the grown-ups are with you in wanting to make this planet safe and beautiful and full of food and beauty for many, many kids to come. So that's why Jason is our speaker too, so we can see that partnership. And that's why here at church, we have four values. Who can help me here? The teachers, I'm sure, remember what our four core values are. Respect. Respect, kindness, sharing, and planet care. Last week at the egg hunt, we really practiced sharing, because we made sure everybody got enough eggs, right? And another way we practice sharing is that we grow food in our garden and then we give it all away to people. You know, people donate for it and then we take their donations and we give food away. so that everybody has enough to eat. So that's a lot of what we do to take care of the planet. Does anybody else here do anything on their daily life to take care of the planet? Yes, Heidi. You use a reusable water bottle instead of throwing plastic away. Huge. That's huge. Anybody else? Yes, Stella.
I use containers instead of plastic bags.
These are huge things, and they're great for the ocean. Where's Bridget? We went, Bridget is our mission elder and a tremendous lover of the planet. She organized us in a beach cleanup, and the beach cleanup partner that we had from Surfrider, he said the most important thing you can do for the oceans is use less plastic. It's really good. Anybody else have one they want to share that you do for the Earth? Yes, Bobby. That's right. Plastic bags are dangerous for our sea turtles, so we want to really watch that. That's super important. Are we good? Yes? Okay, so we're going to have a treasure hunt in the backyard, but we have a couple important things to do first. One of the things that we do to show how much we're thankful for the beauty of the earth is we sing about it. So you can have the front row seats. Let's listen to "The Earth Is Yours" from our choir. Come on up this way and point yourself this way and get the front row seats for the song. Come just right up here. Sit right here. Don't let this block you. Yeah, that's great.
It thunders, the oaks are twisting, the forest sounds with cedars breaking. The waters see you and start their writhing, from the depths a song is rising. It's rising from the ground. It's rising from the ground. Holy, 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 holy Lord. The earth is yours and singing. Holy, 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 holy Lord. The earth is yours. Your voice, it thunders, the ground is shaking, the mighty mountains now are trembling. Creation sees you and starts composing, the fields and trees, they start rejoicing. Now it's rising from the ground. Now it's rising from the ground. Hear us crying out. Hear us crying out. Holy, 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 holy Lord. The earth is yours and singing. Holy, holy. Rising from the ground. Now it's rising from the ground. Hear us crying out. Hear us crying out. Holy, 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 holy Lord. The earth is yours. Singing, oh. earth is yours. The earth is yours. The earth is yours. The earth is yours.
Right. Now, let's all stand up right where we are and stretch like a tree, because the next song is about trees. Stand up, stand up. Whoa, everybody, this is very good for you. You'll never have to go to a chiropractor if you just stand up and stretch like a tree every day. My chiropractor would be unhappy to hear me say that. All right, okay, now let's hear a song giving. Sit down.
And I saw a tree by the riverside. One day as I walked along, straight as an arrow and pointing to the sky, growing tall and strong. How do you grow so tall and strong? I said to the riverside tree, this is the song that my tree friend sang to me. Well, I've got roots growing down to the water. I've got leaves growing up to the sunshine. And the fruit that I bear is a sign of the life in me. And I am shade from the hot summer sundown. I am nest for the birds of the heavens. I'm becoming what the maker of trees has meant me to be. A strong young tree. Well, I saw a tree in the winter time when snow lay on the ground, straight as an arrow and pointing to the sky, and the winter winds blew all around. How do you grow so straight and tall? I said to my wintertime tree, this is the song that my tree friend sang to me. Well, I've got roots growing down to the water. I've got leaves growing up to the sunshine. And the fruit that I bear is a sign of the life in me. And I am shade from the hot summer sundown. I am nest for the birds of the heavens. I'm becoming what the maker of trees has meant me to be. A strong young tree. Well, I saw a tree in the city streets where buildings block the sun. Green and lovely I could see, it gave joy to everyone. How do you grow in the city streets? I said to my downtown tree, this is the song that my tree friend sang to me. Well, I've got roots growing down to the water. I've got leaves growing up to the sunshine. And the fruit that I bear is a sign of the life in me. And I am shade from the hot summer sundown. I am nest for the birds of the heavens. I'm becoming what the maker.
has meant me to be a strong young tree.
Much. Okay, now, unless you're reading a text, okay, which means Spencer and Claire and Julia and, yes, definitely Heidi and Cooper. Even though you're in front of me, I saw you. This is good. Okay, so, but otherwise, everyone else can go downstairs with Max and Jack, okay? And you're just going to get to play outside for now. And then the treasure hunt will start when the readers come down, okay? So keep them all together, guys. If you want to stay upstairs with Pup, you can listen to the girls. What do you want to do? Yes, you stay up here. Stay up there with the girls.
A lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And when I feel afraid, I think I've lost my way, still you're there. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. And Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. And I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto
a light unto
and a light unto my path. Yes, you're the light unto my path.
You don't, you want me to read that part? Come with me. And our first scripture reader this morning is Spencer Simon.
Scripture. Okay.
Right into the mic.
Our first Hebrew scripture readings is from Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. And God took Adam and put him in the Garden of Eden to farm it and care for it.
Amen.
Amen.
And now a reading from Psalm 104, God the Creator and Provider. And can we call forward Julia, Claire, Cooper, and Heidi? And you can just line up in order. Julia, do you need the chair? Can you reach it? I think you got it. There you go. Right in there.
God, you provide streams of water in the hills and valleys so that the donkeys and other wild animals and can satisfy their thirst. Birds build their nests nearby and sing in the trees from your home above. and send rain on the hills and water on the water there.
Thank you.
You let the earth produce grass for cattle, plants for our food, wine to cheer us up, olive oil for our skin, and grain for our health. O Lord, your trees always have water, and so do the cedars you planted in Lebanon.
Birds nest in those trees, wild goats find a home. In the tall mountains, and small animals can hide between the rocks. You created the moon to tell us the seasons. The sun knows when to set, and you made the darkness so the animals in the forest could come out at night.
Lions roar as they hunt for the food you provide, but when morning comes, they return to their dens. Then people go out to work until the end of the day. O Lord, how manifold are your works. By your wisdom, you made so many things. The whole earth is full of your living creatures. Amen.
I want to thank those wonderful youth readers, and then I'd like to call forward Mission Elder Bridget Clark to introduce Hayley Ballard. And all you kids, you have a choice. You can go downstairs with Kelsey now to do the treasure hunt and then come back for when your parents are ordained and installed and or speaking. So that's up to you. Kelsey's going downstairs for the treasure hunt now.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Earth Day service with Hayley. She is a youth leader who is on the San Anselmo Climate Action Committee. And she's quite a leader that I'm very proud of and happy to introduce. Welcome.
I wanted to start by saying thank you so much for having me here today. I'm so honored to speak at your congregation, and I recognize many of you out there. So I'm just so honored to be part of this community today and that you've let me speak. Like Bridget said, I am a youth commissioner on the Climate Action Commission. I'm also a junior at San Domenico, just down the road. And I'm an avid runner and biker, so I feel it's especially meaningful for me to be able to talk today on Earth Sunday because I feel that I'm able to enjoy the amazing environment we have around us every day. And like Pastor Bev said, I've felt like this heavy burden sometimes of trying to protect the planet. And I've been scared of losing places that I love, like this natural environment we have, and also the communities that I love. And that's kind of what's fueled me to go into environmental activism. And one personal story that I would like to share with you guys today of something that brings me hope is actually a story about my grandparents who are sitting in the crowd today. They have lived on a ranch up in Sonoma for several decades now. And I have very fond memories of that ranch when I was growing up, like stomping in the creek, picking wild irises. So it was quite a blow to us when we learned when I was younger that because of the rising sea levels, a highway needs to be built over part of the ranch. But what's been truly inspiring to watch is that my grandparents have turned this kind of negative thing, this detrimental aspect, into an opportunity. Like they've been engaging with the California government to help restore the creek running through the ranch, rebuild the riparian corridor, bring back the salmon that used to live there, and even Caltrans is required to do like environmental reparations for any damage that they cause, such as building a highway. So they're looking at turning the ranch into a model of regenerative farming and having rotational grazing of the cattle on the land so that instead of degrading the land, the cattle can fill a natural herbivore niche and help restore the ecosystem. So it's been truly inspiring to watch, like, going from this fear of losing this place that is very special to my family to kind of watching it transform into something that even that's even better than it was. And I think this really speaks to how, in terms of solving the climate crisis, we have the tools we need. We have the tools we need. We have what we know we can do. And this is something I've seen time and time again from the older members of the Climate Action Commission that of San Anselmo, which I've been so honored to watch. So I just wanted to touch on, like, some of the things that the Climate Action Commission, who I'm representing today, has done in the past year or so, and kind of what you guys can all do as a community to help support us, support our work. So the first thing is, earlier this fall, we passed a leaf blower ordinance, and you're probably looking at me like, so what, leaf blowers? But leaf blowers, actually using a leaf blower for 1 hour is equivalent to driving your car 1,100 miles. So the town of San Anselmo has banned gas-powered leaf blowers, which is a huge step in just trying to, as a community, reduce the amount of emissions we're producing. We are also working on building electrification homes. The Climate Action Commission just actually last month presented to the town council a draft ordinance on requiring electric infrastructure for, like, heaters, water heaters, rather than gas, because natural gas in home contributes to 33% of town emissions. So what you can do in that regard is, when you have a chance, when it comes time to replace your gas stove and water heaters, use electricity. And I know that cost can be a barrier in many regards to that, but the Climate Action Commission is also working on rebates and incentives that will soon be posted on our website to help with that. And additionally, one of the best things you can do is opting up to MCE Deep Green, which means that your electricity is 100% renewable. And I was pretty amazed when I learned this, but it only costs 1 penny more per kilowatt hour. So it's like $5 more a month to have your energy be completely electric. Since July, the Climate Action Commission has also been working on a fleet electrification plan, which I think is super cool, because it means that all of the town-owned vehicles, like trucks for the public work department, would be electric. So the town would be leading by example. We also are considering putting gas pump warning labels, which I think is speaking to, like, also our individual responsibility to the planet. Like, so on a gas pump, it would say, like, consumption of fossil fuels contributes to global warming, which is threatening the earth. And what you can do to support that is, I know it's pretty obvious, but continuing to get out of your car. My family has several e-bikes, so it's sometimes a little bit funny to watch, but my mom will e-bike my brother to school occasionally on the back of the bike. And yeah, transportation is a major aspect, as 55% of our emissions in the town come from transportation. And then also reducing single-use plastics. The town Climate Action Commission, now that's kind of post-COVID, is finally working with the town council to have an ordinance to ban single-use plastics. Yay, which is super exciting, something I'm really excited about. So you can, I have some postcards out there on reusable foodware, and also, like, in considering to support those businesses that are doing their part to reduce single-use plastic. And then, going beyond commission work, I wanted to touch on a couple more things that you can do. One of them is composting. I know you guys have a beautiful garden out back, so you are probably already very on top of that. But California is now requiring all food waste to be composted, which is super exciting. And even though it might seem like a small thing, composting food waste rather than putting it in the landfill reduces the amount of methane emissions from waste by 50%. And methane is a very potent greenhouse gas. Each molecule of methane
literally will warm the planet like 20 times more than each molecule of carbon dioxide. So by just simply composting, I think it's super cool that you can have such big of an impact. Last thing I want to touch on is greenwashing, which is, and kind of like, I know you guys are all very leaders in this community, environmental advocates, but it's very easy to be a little bit like duped or tricked, because a lot of times now companies want to be green and they're like, oh yeah, buy our product, it's sustainable. But oftentimes that's not the case, such as like a plastic bag where it might say, oh, you can reuse this plastic bag. We know that it's better to just not use the plastic bag in the first place. So just, I want like you guys all of you in this congregation are amazing leaders. So I just want to say, like, hold your ground and do what you know is right. Don't let anyone persuade you. And so I know that the climate crisis can be very difficult to talk about. And we sometimes feel, or at least I feel paralyzed about, like, what can I do? But I think being able to have these conversations as a community and come together as a community is truly inspiring. And we have all the tools we need. So I'm really excited to see what we can accomplish as a community. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was great. Thank you so much.
Oh yeah, grab that. Got it. Great, Hayley. Thank you so much. And I hope that, and welcome to your family. Oh my gosh, thank you for being here. And I hope you can stay around, because we, you know, I know there are people who are going to want to thank you and ask you questions after the service, and also pick up your materials that you brought. So Bridget will, you know, help you deal with all the people that want to talk to you. So, all right. So now Ryan is going to introduce Jason.
Jason, there you are. Yeah, Jason is, he currently serves as the senior director, head of policy and government affairs for Enphase Energy, and he's also an adjunct instructor within the Masters of Energy Systems Management program at USF. He brings years of experience in global solar, renewable energy, market development, and a clean energy technology. So join me in welcoming Jason.
Thanks very much. Good morning, everybody. Happy Earth Week. So I didn't really prepare any formal remarks because I really wanted to hear what Hayley was going to say and try to address accordingly and provide a little bit more context on the other side of the coin. So Hayley provided a great example of community activism and what you could do at the local level, and really that's my message today as well. I sit on the other side of the coin. We provide the technologies to enable organizations like Hayley and obviously communities like ours to really engage and really do something about the climate issue, as well as mitigate against obviously the effects of climate change. So Enphase Energy is who I work with, is a company that really grew from the idea of two people back in 1999, I believe it was, in a little shop up in Petaluma. And it was an interesting concept that was brought to bear that came out of the communications industry by two engineers that were immigrants, one French and one from India, who said that, you know what, the energy industry is due for a transformation, and we need to figure out how we can do this better. So they set out to design something, a single line diagram, in 1999, which ends up being today one of the most prolific technologies that exists within the solar energy industry today. So on the roof of the church here, we have solar collectors or solar panels. And underneath those solar panels sit these little things called microinverters. So this company, Enphase Energy, had invented the first microinverter. And today they're in their 11th generation. And what's interesting about the evolution of this company is it started with two people in a little shop up in Petaluma, and now it's larger than Pacific Gas and Electric. So there is hope. that transformation is happening. There's a revolution. And I could honestly tell you that these two people, through just pure human ambition, had created something that is truly transformative. And it will be, not only in the US, but also across the world. I think back in 1999, they were operating in the US. 2017, they were still in the US. Now they're over in 130 countries. And what's more important about that is that now we're starting to see that these technologies are not only getting into the hands of the people that could afford them, they're actually getting into the hands through incentives on a global scale to disadvantaged communities and to people that are in lower income and people that are obviously affected by the ravages and the impact of climate change. So I guess I'm here to say that the revolution is here. You just don't know it. People, you know, like me and Hayley and others are part of this movement. You know, I think another message is, you know, don't lose hope, because at the end of the day, like two people sitting in one small office had created a monumental change. And we're going to see the evolution of the technology over the course of the next decade. So, for example, you're probably not aware, but in 2035, every new vehicle that's sold in California has to be an electric vehicle. So we're all going to be driving electric vehicles. Well, you know, it's companies like Enphase Energy and others that are going to be, you know, evolving the technology to allow your vehicle, for example, to not only, you know, obviously charge from your home, but your vehicle is going to be charging your home. And your vehicle is going to be providing services back to the grid. So there's not going to be a need to upgrade the grid to the extent that you've actually seen in the past. So we're looking at huge cost savings. We're looking at the optimization of energy at the local level. Like, this all starts at the local community level, right? People are going to be generating their own energy on top of the roofs like they are now, but they're also going to be creating these home energy systems where they're going to be completely self-sustaining with zero greenhouse gas emissions. Another exciting thing. So Hayley had mentioned, you know, building electrification, for example, which is what I'm touching on here. So the California Energy Commission, who's responsible for, you know, creating codes and standards and stuff like that with respect to efficiency standards within your homes, they have just passed a requirement that has a greenhouse gas benchmark in it that is going to require everybody now to use an electric heat pump. And that's going to essentially take everybody off natural gas. Okay, there's also 42 communities in California that have just banned the use of natural gas hookups to homes. So the revolution is happening, right? The European Commission is going to be accelerating the adoption of renewable energy. The state of California just increased their renewable standard, I think it's 70% by something like 2045. It's like just an astounding amount of activity that's happening that is just pushing us towards this common goal. So when you see, you know, all the negative print in the headlines, and you see obviously what's happening, you know, across the world, that, you know, could kind of get you down, just know that, you know, there is a revolution happening, and you should never bet against the human condition, and you should never bet against humanity. And that's my message today. And if you start at the local level, if you do something small, and if you can, if you're persistent, and if you dig away, and if you keep chipping away, you might do something that could be earth-changing. And that's my Earth Day commentary. Thank you.
So much, Jason. Thank you. Thank you. That was great.
Sure.
Thank you. Well, thank you both so much. This is very inspiring, and we know that our folks are going to want to talk to you both after the service, so that's terrific. Now, Ryan, you can go downstairs. Would you all like to go downstairs with Ryan, just have a little quick chat, and then scoop up everyone and bring them at the end of the prayers? I know they're having a wonderful time in the backyard, but bring them back for the ordination and installation. We just need a few minutes, actually. So you all go get to know each other a little bit, and then come right back with all the kids. Okay? Does that sound good?
Thank you.
as we come to our time of prayer and we're remembering all of our folks at home too, let's all settle into our pews or our comfy seats at home. Breath. We're grateful for the breath. We're grateful for the pitter-patter of little feet too. Holy One, thank you so much for the beauty and bounty of the earth. Thank you for this planet, our home. Thank you for all the creatures. Thank you for all the wonderful, passionate people like Hayley and Jason who are really dedicating their lives to leading this revolution, and help us all to be a really meaningful part of it. Help us to remember, like what the kids said, no more plastic in the ocean. Let's really all be in solidarity and be hopeful and joyful that we can do this. With your guidance, with your energy filling us up, we lift up prayers for everyone who's struggling with every kind of difficulty in our congregation and in the wide world. People who don't have enough food, don't have enough good, clean water, don't have fresh air to breathe, don't have peace in their homes and in their countries. We ask for God's peace to just enfold us and help us to be peacemakers and bring more peace to our lives and to the world. We lift up especially today all those who are bereaved from the loss of a loved one, and we ask for comfort and love to fill their spirits. God, in your grace. You hear our prayers. So yeah, so Sharon's lifting up prayers for Darren Overby, who's a good long friend of the church in his humanitarian mission to the border of Ukraine. So God, in your grace. I'm so glad you're with us, Mary Beth, and we will pray for your friend Judy, who's bereaved over the loss of her husband, Bob. May God comfort her. God, in your grace. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together and use the name for God that brings you closest to God in your heart. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, we're actually calling all the children back. So yeah, help us out with that. That would be great. So I'd like to call forward this very special moment in the life of the church. I'd like to call forward Anna Welch and Damon Blechen, who are being ordained to ruling elder and installed, and Patti Vance, who is previously ordained but being installed. So you all three can just stand right there. That's fantastic. And then the clerk of session, Jody Brockett, and I
will be leading us. Everyone find your insert to your bulletin. We're not there quite yet, but we'll get there. Okay. Jody, why don't you stand? Oh, you know, you're going to need the mic. Let's see. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, come on. There we go. Okay. Oh, okay, good. In ordination, oh, this is the Book of Order, which is the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church, USA. In ordination, the church sets apart with prayer and the laying on of hands those who have been called through election by the church to serve as deacons, ruling elders, and teaching elders. In installation, the church sets apart with prayer those previously ordained as deacons, ruling elders, and teaching elders and called anew to service in ministry.
So we're welcoming today our duly elected elders, which we voted on at the annual meeting of the congregation March 27th. And so today I want to welcome Damon Blechen and Anna Welch and Patti Vance.
And then why don't you lead off by introducing Damon?
Okay, so I'm going to introduce Damon this morning. And he is the father of twins, Heidi and Cooper, who are 12 years old, and they go to White Hill now. And then he's his wife Mo is here also, and they've been married for 18 years. And Damon grew up in Southern California, and he attended a large church regularly. And so he's been a longtime supporter also of the Sleepy Hollow Youth Ministry here. And he's been a terrific athlete and now coaches youth sports. And he works as a financial advisor, and he brings that experience to the position of finance elder. So
welcome,
thank you,
Damon.
Very much.
Round of applause.
Yeah.
Koren Grubb, our worship elder, will introduce Anna Welch.
This is Anna Welch, and she is our new. Oh, this is Anna Welch, and she is our new. Excuse me. Our new elder for Youth and Family Ministries. She's been coming to Sleepy Hollow Presbyterian Church for 5 years when her and her husband Justin moved to San Anselmo. They have 3 daughters and a dog. She is a real estate attorney and an amateur but enthusiastic gardener. Welcome.
Welcome, Anna.
Welcome.
Round of applause,
Anna.
Please. And it is my pleasure to welcome back Patti Vance to the session. Patti is a community member who has been attending this church for 35 years. She has 2 sons and 3 grandchildren. She is, this is the biography that she wrote. I'm going to have to, she's so modest and humble. It's like, what? She's interested in gardening. She's an incredible gardener and has been co-leading the Justice Garden and brought so much to the church in so many areas. Previous mission elder, and you know, just we couldn't have our garden without Patti. So she was also project manager for a 2-year feasibility study commissioned by the Marin Board of Supervisors and the Marin Community Foundation to develop an education farm and garden. As a result, a 6-acre organic farm was established at the College of Marin's Indian Valley campus. Her own garden features a habitat for pollinators and wildlife and was recently featured in a regional publication. It's like, I didn't know that. So Patti has been an active member in the Marin education community for over 30 years, serving as a trustee for the Ross Valley School District and manager of the Integrated Studies program at Archie Williams High School. She's faculty coordinator now for the nonprofit Point Blue Conservation Sciences education programs, STRAW, Students and Teachers Restoring a Watershed, which provides environmental education for over 3,000 K-12 students annually in the North Bay, Sierras, and Peninsula. And you're not in Pennsylvania yet. And so let's all welcome Patti, who's coming in as Building and Grounds Elder. Yeah, that was good, right? The ruling elder is defined in the Book of Order as this. As there were in Old Testament times elders for the government of the people, so the New Testament church provides persons with particular gifts to share in discernment of God's spirit and governance of God's people. Congregations should elect persons of wisdom and maturity of faith, having demonstrated skills in leadership and being compassionate in spirit. I think the congregation has done well with this. So let the congregation now read the litany that is in your bulletin, and here you all. There you go. You got. Can you share one with me? Yeah. Everybody found their litany? Let's wait till Anna gets hers. There are different gifts. There are different ways of serving God. God works through different people in different ways. Each one is given gifts by the Spirit. Together we are the body of Christ. Though we have different gifts, together we are a ministry of reconciliation led by the living Christ. We work and pray to make the church useful in the world, and we call men and women to bring their gifts to that end. Within our common ministry, some members are chosen for particular work as elders and deacons. In ordination and installation, we recognize these special ministries, remembering that Jesus taught us that greatness lies in service to the church and to the world. Very good. Now, I'm looking around, and I don't see, did Heidi and Cooper come back, or are they still downstairs with Ryan? Okay, we need to send, boys, get Ryan and then all the kids to come back up. Somehow that message got confused. We don't want to ordain Damon without his children here. So, very good. All right. They'll be back in just a moment. Sorry about that little glitch. Okay. So, then what happens next? We've got you back. That's fantastic. You have to be here to listen to your dad getting ordained and installed and answering his questions. All right, here are the constitutional questions. Do you trust in Jesus, head of the church? If so, say we do. We do. Will you fulfill your ministry following him? Will you be governed by the church's polity and be a friend to your colleagues in ministry? Will you in your own life seek to love your neighbors and work for the reconciliation of the world? No. Do you promise to further the peace and unity of the church? No. Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, imagination, and love? Will you be a faithful elder providing for worship, nurture, and service? And in your own ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus? That's wonderful. Jody has questions for the congregation.
Okay, do we, the members of the church, accept Damon, Anna, and Patti chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ.
We do.
Do we agree to pray for them, to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church?
We do.
The children tested this. We used to have kneelers. I'm not sure this meets my safety requirements, but they tested this because it is in the Book of Order that the ordination includes kneeling for the laying on of hands, and then the installed person doesn't have to kneel. So we will now see if we can do this. So Damon, and I would your daughter recommended you hold on to the chair. Yes. How does that work? Okay, we're going to make it quick. Okay. So please would all who have been previously ordained as elders and deacons of the church come forward for the laying on of hands. And we will say a prayer. Just hop back up if it's uncomfortable. Yeah. All who have been ordained as deacons and elders, please come forward. Patti, you're a deacon. Yeah. Everybody, has that got everybody who's ordained? Yeah, let's make sure we've got everyone. Okay. Let us pray. Wait a minute, where's Patti? You're involved here too, yeah. Okay, good. All right. Somebody put a shoulder, yeah, there you go. Yeah. Yeah. Holy Lord, thank you for calling these three beautiful people to leadership of the church. We know that we have received your guidance in electing them, people of fine character, people of great faith and wisdom, people with hearts of compassion. May they feel your blessing every day of their lives, and may they especially feel your blessing as they walk in their leadership here, guiding this church on your path of love and light and building the world. In your name we pray, amen. All right, beautiful, you can stand up. Well done. That was good. Oh, I have one more thing to do, sorry. Okay, don't go away yet. There's a proclamation. Okay. You are now ruling elders in the Church of Jesus Christ for this congregation. Whatever you do in word and deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through him. Amen. Will the congregation please welcome our newly ordained and installed elders. Thank you. Thank you all so much for everything that you do to support the church. We are entirely self-supporting by your contributions. Thank you so much for everything that you are doing. The morning offering will now be taken. Thank you. Please pray with me. Holy One, we give thanks that we have received so much and given back in faith. We trust that these, our generous gifts, will be put to good and faithful use, bringing about a more just and peaceful world for all people. Amen. Thank you. Do we have any announcements today? Patty's co-garden guru.
We had a really lovely planting session yesterday, and we're having another one today at about 11 o'clock or so after fellowship. Out in the garden, tomatoes, we planted basil yesterday, beets, and getting the gardens ready for putting in other crops as well. So it was just fun to do. Please, if you feel like it, come out and get your hands in the muck and plant some stuff.
All right, thank you. my life and mission partner is, he's wearing sunglasses because he lost his glasses. So it's not just totally a celebrity look. Bridget. We have a hand. Nice. Thank you, Bridget. Thank you so much. Any other announcements? Yes. Don't go home without vegetables, I think is the message. Pam Selvig. Okay.
So I have a kid friendly announcement. Next Sunday, right after church at 11, I'm hosting a concert, piano recital / kid friendly concert. Alex is nice enough to help me out with a couple of the songs and featuring Rowan. Rowan's going to be in one of the songs, and Claire and Julia. And
okay, so this is 11 o'clock next Sunday, May 1st, and there's practice, a little bit practice today? Yeah. That'll be great. Thank you, Pam. We're very pleased to have the sanctuary filled with youth music. That's awesome. Okay, so let's all stand for our last hymn, and then we'll have fellowship and make sure we welcome our and thank our speakers and our elders. For the Beauty of the Earth, number 14.
For the beauty of the joy, for the joy of human love, brother, sister, parent, child, friends on earth and friends above, for all gentle thoughts and mild, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For the joy of ear and eye, for the heart and mind's delight, for the mystic harmony, linking sense to sound and sight, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our thyself best gift, for thyself best gift divine, to our world so freely given, for that great, great love of thine, peace on earth and joy in heaven, Lord of all, to our hymn of grateful praise.
Let's have a hand for those musicians. Woohoo! Thank you everyone for this very special day. So you can remain standing. This will be quick. Please receive your charge and benediction, and then I'm going to ask our newly ordained and installed to come recess with me, and also our speakers. We're going to have a long line out there so everyone can say thank you to you. Okay? So receive this charge. As you go out from here, take time every day to thank God for the beauty and bounty of this earth, and let God fill you with hope that we indeed are finding a solution to all the world's problems together. And may our Lord Jesus Christ, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the constant companionship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you this day and forever. Amen. Go in peace. All right, speakers and elders, come with me.